instrument for the institute, but as well as my pain. We are making that vaccine here in India. We should have been able to eliminate measles and rubella in our country first, and then others should have been benefited. But a reverse thing has happened here. But I'm quite confident that the new leadership in the country and new dynamics, which is I am seeing in the health department, the same thing could be achieved very quickly in India. I think as His Excellency has already mentioned that we have now taken over one of the units in Netherlands. This unit was in raid for more than 10 years, and that was the reason why the Netherlands government wanted to put it on the block. We bidded for it, we took it over in 2012, and today I am ready to inform you, His Excellency, that this year, this unit which was in raid has now come in black. But of course, the greatest challenge that I see globally is not what we have done, vaccine manufacturers in the US. There is Pfizer, Merck, and Medimune. All others are there, but they are just making few million doses or in the government sector for the army. In EU, there were almost 37 manufacturers. Today again, if you count, there are only three. It is GSK, Sanofi, and Vilcovan Biologics, which now belongs to us. Okay. My worry is, globally, if anything happens, whether in the US or in EU, there could be crisis because vaccine manufacturing is not easy. You have to constantly on your toes, have your GMP in place, and make these products which meet the international quality. And if by, for some reason, the plant closes down, there is tremendous pressure on the manufacturer to supply the product. And there what the opportunities are available for our Indian manufacturers. And if we could do it, anybody else can do it. When we developed the meningococcal vaccine, we were interacting with 23 different laboratories and agencies for development of this product. And therefore, I feel that the Indian manufacturers do have an opportunity, and especially with the support from the biotechnology and BioAct, they can rise and supply, make in India and supply globally. Thank you.
I wish we had time for questions, but we now have to go for the valedictory, where Dr. Ramchandra Guha will give his talk. So I know there are a lot of questions. I hope that all of you will stay on for lunch, mingle with the panelists, and ask your questions. So thank you all very, very much for having me on.
Can you show this? I extend a warm welcome to all the dividends and guys and all members of the audience. It's time to draw curtains on the Reverend Dudley and summarize the Senate proceedings.
ये बताओ बायोडाइवर्सिटी खत्म होती जा रही है. हेलो, आवाज नहीं आ रही आपको?
हेलो,
आवाज आ
रही है? How we make India a destination of rising knowledge. All the stakeholders who have come together in this summit, the scientists, the industry, the researchers, the entrepreneurs, the government, both, and most interestingly, our over 200 college students. A very, very big thank you to all of you for being here. This was really the whole energy that came into this summit was because of your presence here. You had over 1200 participants yesterday in the inaugural, and we have even till late last evening, and we concluded our session as of 7:30 last evening. It was very interesting to see such a large audience with us. We have over this last 1.5 day, we had 6 sessions in which we have deliberated on what is our future goal, where we stand today actually, and then what is our future goal and the environment strategy, which is what we set up for ourselves. We've set out the goal of targets for us. As yesterday in the inaugural, the ministers said, it is a very ambitious target, but we all are confident that we will be able to achieve it together as a community. So what we have done in these sessions is to discuss this and say, how do we actually make this a target for ourselves, and how do we achieve that target? Which is the target of all of us at the moment. We had 6 sessions, and there was a galaxy of eminent speakers and panelists. We had 4 plenary talks. We were fortunate that we had our former secretaries, Dr. Anu Sharma, Dr. C.R. Bhatia, and Dr. M.K. Mann deliver talks to us. We were also very fortunate that we had the Nobel laureate, Karen Minnett, and the director, Malia Kutu, to be with us for this. Each session had the biotechnology interventions for health, for a healthy nation, biotechnology for inclusive development and food security. We then had our international and national corporations, the forging corporations, and most importantly, creating a skilled workforce. All these sessions have, as I said, deliberated on the various components of how do we get our action plan ready to move. It has been very interesting to get the summary record of all these various thoughts. Some of them were moderated panel discussions, some of them were actual presentations. We will attempt to put together the summary of this summit. It's going to be a massive task. And I can see most of my younger colleagues wondering how they're going to put that together. But I'm sure as a team we'll try to put that together, because it's very important for us to summarize and capture the essence of this whole discussion. I think it's very important also for us to see how do we translate this into the action. What we have seen over 30 years has been the action that we've taken so far to reach here. But I think now that the confidence and also the expectations from DBT have really increased, it's important to see how do we achieve that. We set a goal till 2025, but most of you heard our minister say DBT is capable of advancing it by 5 years. It's a challenge, but at least we could try and see how we do that. We would like to thank once again everyone who's been part of this whole discussion, for this interaction. And as we come to the close of the summit, our valedictory session, we have with us an excellent orator, Mr. Guha, who's going to speak to us. And I think all of you sitting here are waiting eagerly for this talk, so I'm not going to extend this summit summary more than this. But thank you very much for being here, Mr. Guha. We would like to give you a very, very warm welcome. And our welcome in the traditional biotechnology style is not with a bouquet of flowers, but with a plant. And we give you a tissue culture plant which has been produced at one of our own tissue culture facilities. Environment Secretary DBT to introduce the speaker before we hear Mr. Kumar.
Thank you very much, Rayo. It's, of course, you know, the standard way we introduce people like Goa is to say that he needs no introduction and then go on to introduce him. So he does need no introduction, but you know, the excuse I have of giving a little bit of introduction is that there are some who don't know the multiple facets of his interest in this career. Ram studied in Delhi and in various places. His father was a public servant as well, a scientist, I think, and this took him to multiple locations all over the country. And this was a very interesting characteristic of post-independence India, that, you know, we were actually a much more difficult country at that time in many ways, but the group of people who grew up as children of government servants who went around the country, in many ways, took on the cosmopolitan nature of the country and became true Indians in the process. Ram studied in Delhi, and he also, I think, went on to do an equivalent of a PhD at the Indian School of Management, Calcutta. And this combination of elite institutions could have secured him a steady position as a dominant in one of our universities. But rather than do that, he actually took up a completely independent life, and that really is, that kind of attitude symbolizes him in many, many ways. History in India has been written with a very strong link with political views, either left or right, and so on and so forth. And Ram is very unusual in being very critical of both and being actually completely innovative and new in his approaches. He was one of the first, one of the few historians who looked at cricket in interesting ways. And he's looked at, you know, contemporary history, post-independence history, which is a very dangerous topic to get into, because, you know, people who participated in those histories are still alive. And he's done that with scholarship, with understanding, combining, you know, all the details together so that the facts speak for themselves. This history of, you know, post-independence, for example, you just have to read through this. There is very little opinion there, but all the events are so nicely pieced together that you can actually, you know, make your own opinion and your own views. Well, I won't stand between Ram and you. He's a fantastic speaker, as you've heard Rayo say. We're also running late, and it's really very really important that he say what he has to say. Ram.
He was India's leading wood scientist. His name was Dr. V. Narayan Murthy.
preservation from the 30s. In fact, in the 40s, he designed the wood that was used in the mosquito net. Only played in World War II, basically made of wood, and he would take hopping flights from India across North Africa to Europe. He did a PhD in Danzig, now called Gdansk. He was there about the same time that that is described in Günter Grass's great novel, The Tin Drum. And one of my abiding regrets is that he died before I read Günter Grass and could ask him about Nazis and Danzig in the 1930s. And he then founded the Indian Plywood Research Institute in Bangalore. He was a top person. My father was a decent scientist, competent, hardworking. My grandfather was better, and my uncle was even better. My uncle, whose name would be known to some of you in this room, was one of the greatest Indian scientists of the 20th century. His name was K. Venkatraman. He was the director of the National Chemical Laboratory. He also wrote, apart from his many scientific papers, was translated into many languages, including Russian. And the problems in those days of writing a bestseller in Russian is that the rubles never came to you. And my uncle was an extremist man, so he once took my aunt to Moscow simply to spend the rubles that were there in Moscow. But my aunt, being a vegetarian, could not buy any caviar. My uncle, being a teetotaler, could not, had no interest in buying the vodka. So I said, the rubles still sit somewhere. The rubles from the Russian translation of K. Venkatraman's synthetic dyes still sit somewhere in Moscow. Now these three people, I was especially close to. One was my father, one was my grandfather, and one was my uncle, who had a special fondness for me, and whom I would spend some holidays in Pune, and who always insisted that I, he would say, Ram would be my last PhD student. Now this didn't come to pass for two reasons. One, I was a not very good student in science. I did science in high school. I was okay in chemistry, okay in maths, but disastrous in physics and biology. And I knew that if you did science, if you joined a college with a good cricket team, you would have practicals in the afternoon, so you could not attend net practice and you would not be chosen for the team. So I did not do science. But I owe a great debt. There are other people in my family who are also very distinguished in the world of science. One who is at the level of K. Venkatraman, I have not mentioned, though I am devoted to him, is my mother's brother. Because he did not contribute to Indian science but to American science. So let that be. So, but I grew up in an atmosphere of science and scientists, and my father, my grandfather, and my uncle, Dr. Venkatraman, the three of them helped nourish my interest in research and ideas. They of course paid for my education. And they showed me how scholarship could be intellectually stimulating as well as a contribution to public service. By reflecting on these three formative influences on me, my father, the paper chemist, my grandfather, the wood technologist, my uncle, the great synthetic chemist, I recognized that they were animated by the idea of public service, but also quite unusually for scientists at the time. They had been doing this, though actually doing the kind of thing that UD is doing through this wonderful conference, that they were not holed up in their lab, but they were making a wider connection to the economic and social growth of India. My father, my uncle, and my grandfather, all of whom worked in the government and public institutions, were what I like to call unself-conscious patrons. You know, they didn't fly the Kakarinda outside the house. Even if they had been allowed, they would not have been flown outside the house. They loved their country. And they were patriots in a sense in which I think it's important to underline. They were in a sense patriots who were cosmopolitan, as Vijay mentioned. And they were patriots and not nationalists. I think there's an important distinction. A patriot is someone who loves his or her country. A nationalist is someone who hates the other person's country. And growing up in this atmosphere of unconscious patriots, then of course, then later becoming a historian and writing a book on the foundations of independent India, I am struck by this distinction. It's very important, especially for the young, to recognize the distinction between patriotism and nationalism. To be a patriot in Indian, you do not even have to hate Pakistan. So this kind of unself-conscious idea of public service and redundant, that's what my talk is about. How it was once widespread and ubiquitous among people in government, not just among scientists, you know, among people in the civil service, the police, the judiciary, the revenue department. Why is this shunned? What's the, is there a kind of a need, and I believe there's a need, which is what my talk is about, a need for a renewed emphasis on public service. But before I come to that, I want to give you a kind of analytical picture of what I think of how to better appreciate the functioning of any democracy, not just India, any democracy. My view, the health of every major democracy depends on the proper functioning of three distinct but interrelated sectors, which I should call the government, the private sector, and civil society. So there are three major sectors in which you divide your political and your economic and social life: the state, the private sector, and civil society. And you should think of India, indeed of any major democracy, as a stool with three legs: state, civil society, and private sector, and a stool that is robust and strong and solid when all of each of its three legs are robust and strong and solid. So keep this picture with you, but this is very the kind of core analytical argument of my talk, that every democracy depends on the healthy functioning of the state, the private sector, and civil society in an interrelated fashion. And each of these sectors has a different role to perform. The job of the government is to provide law and order, basic social services, such as education, health, equality of opportunity, so that birth and privilege or gender or caste privilege does not excessively determine the chances, and defense against external enemies. So that's the job of the state. Provide law and order, basic social services, equality of opportunity, and defense against external enemies. The job of the private sector is to generate wealth and income as about a quarter of the population, so we say 300 million people, depending on the population, right? It's the fundamental responsibility of the private sector, not the public sector, to provide jobs, incomes, opportunity, and to do so through continuous technical and managerial and entrepreneurship innovation, which is in a sense what this celebration of DVD's 30th anniversary is all about. So the job of the government is basic social services, law and order, equality of opportunity. The job of the private sector, the primary response of the private sector, is to provide incomes and jobs. And the duty of civil society is to make the other two sectors honest. So you have the state, you have the private sector, and then you have civil society, which has to hold both government and private sector accountable. Is to shine, the role of the civil society is to shine a spotlight on corruption in government, on cronyism in the private sector, on environmental abuse, on human rights violations. A Chicago economist called Quote in the 1950s, for which he got a Nobel Prize 50 years later. So it's kind of a, it's not just new physics, it's not just Tangra who got a Nobel Prize 50 years after he got it. A.J. Bose got a Nobel Prize many, many years later after his work. And the fundamental fundamental contribution of A.J. Bose's work in economics was the clarion externalities. That it is in the rational interest of a profit maximizing firm to pollute the environment, because the river, the airs are exterminated. And only civil society, aided by the state, can curb this. Likewise, human rights violations by the state. You know, there is no, especially in imperfect democracies like India, where they, I mean, with due respect, the National Human Rights Commission is not an autonomous body. It is the private sector's performance was suboptimal. You know, it was not what we would expect the private sector to do. It was timid and discovers. It wanted state protection all the time. Now the private sector wants the state to withdraw. But in the 50s and 60s, the leading industries of this country wanted the state to guide and protect them.
They wanted a landing seat. The Bombay Plan of 1946, on the treaty of independence, it was signed by, among others, J.R.D. Tata, G.D. Birla, Lala Sriram, Kasturbai Lalbai. Essentially said, we can't invest in power, we can't invest in steel, we can't invest in infrastructure projects. Government has to do all that, provide us all everything at subsidized rates, and then we will make consumer goods. And it was called for subsidies. In fact, Vijay mentioned my early work in Imran. And it was much earlier that in the 1950s, you know, market rate, it's going to lead to environmental degradation. And this trend continued to the 1970s. And in parts of Karnataka, as the studies of Mother Factory have shown, the private sector people for bamboo and one rupee a ton, a basket weaver had to buy it in the open market at 5,000 rupees a ton. So the private sector was always looking for subsidies, always looking for swaps. It was giving at this cost. They weren't doing original research, they weren't going to new areas. It was still the same family business passing from son to grandson and so on and so forth. And objectively, one would have to say that the performance of the private sector, with exceptions perhaps at the Tata's, was suboptimal. It was not daring, it was not innovative, it didn't create enough jobs. They always wanted the protection of the state. At the same time, in the 1950s and 60s, the first two decades of Indian independence, if the performance of the private sector was suboptimal, my argument would be, as a historian who studied these decades closely, civil society was non-existent. There was virtually no civil society in the 50s and 60s. Now, this is contrary to what Gandhi evoked, you know, Mahatma Gandhi. Always emphasized constructive work. You know, he had trained a generation of social workers, and his hope was that you would have to have a civil society organization after independence to keep the state honest. He was inspired in this by his mentor, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, who had started the Servants of India Society, a non-denominational, non-religious civil society organization. And the organization, Gandhi had hoped that in the 1950s and 60s, this would continue. But it did for two reasons. One reason is the aura around the state. You know, when we became independent, politically aware citizens, middle class citizens thought, after decades of struggle, independence has come. There are these towering figures, Nehru, Patel, Ambedkar, Rajaji, Kamaladevi, Chattopadhyay, etc. They are going to bring us not just freedom, which they brought us, but also growth, opportunity, social services. So, civil society as a whole outsourced everything to the state, and enormous expectations. And they ceded their own responsibilities as citizens. The other reason why I should have to use a brand word here, I can recall the usurpation of the Gandhian constructive work tradition by a man called Vinoba Bhave, who is a person of great spiritual integrity, profound scholarly knowledge, but hopelessly impractical. He started the Gulam movement. To oppose the colonies, Vinoba started a non-violent movement, which is a good idea, except that it took bizarre forms. He would go from village to village to village, and through his charisma, get donations of land, and they knew nothing about it. And there was a fascinating argument in the early 50s between Vinoba Bhave and another of Gandhi's followers, an immensely practical and sensible Tamil economist called J.C. Kumarappa, Tamil Christian economist, who wrote to Vinoba. They had been colleagues for Vinoba Sahib, they were to jail together. And Kumarappa had been involved through the 30s and the 40s in reviving and revitalizing village industries. And he wrote to Vinoba. He also had worked on cooperatives and community grazing grounds and village forests and many things. He was really a pioneer of ecologically oriented rural development. So he wrote to Vinoba and said, look, why are you behaving like a sarkari officer, setting targets? 5,000 acres in 1 month, 50,000 next year, 100,000. Forget that. Look at the area you've collected. Get a group of practice constructive workers to organize the villagers for rational economic. economic and environmental management of natural resources. And we don't know how GDP is getting to the silo. Organization is not necessary. Okay, awakening will come from within. There has to be a kind of a spiritual transformation, and everything will take care of itself. And Vinoba Bhave became the leader of the Gandhian movement. He took it on a hopelessly idealistic and impractical track. Later on, he became progressively more and more excited. He also supported. It is surprising to know there were virtually no effective civil society organizations in this country. So here you have a new democracy, born in the most inhospitable circumstances. You know, against the backdrop of partition, 10 million refugees have to be resettled, the princely states have to be integrated, scarcity is stopping the land because the war years of the 1940s had been years of starvation and famine. And in this kind of situation, a new nation is starting to be born, to find its feet, to forge its constitution, to adopt progressive economic and foreign and social policies. And two of the three sectors of this nation, the private sector and civil society, are starting. What happens? Well, the Republic of India is rescued by the state. And this is, in a sense, a story I have told in great detail in my book, India After Gandhi, especially in the first 8 or 9 chapters. How this reckless political experiment of uniting a very diverse and divided country, running in on democratic lines, respecting linguistic and religious pluralism, awarding equal rights to women, taking steps to end undocumentation, and at the same time promoting economic development and an honorable role for India in the world. All this was done essentially because of the superb, over-optimal performance of the state sector. And this, I have told the story at great length in my book, and I want to repeat it here, except to say two things. First, no one expected India to survive. Through the 50s and the 60s, right up to the 70s, there were a series of prophecies of doom written by Western. India will vulcanize into many parts. This nation has no chance. And you know, there's some delicious prophecies, equally, I dare say, by biologists. I mean, if any of you have access to library, go read, go issue a copy of Paul Ehrlich's book, The Population Bomb, whose preface talks about how India is going to go down the tube. I mean, it's not astonishingly evocative paragraph of Paul Ehrlich driving to the streets of this, that the world would die because of overpopulation and India would show the way in collective suicide. Now, but this is one very such prophecies, and they were all falsified. They were falsified because of the visionary leadership, not just by our political class, but also by the civil servants and the public servants of that. Two of the great heroes of my book, whom I'm happy to have brought back in the public domain, because people knew about Nehru and Patel and Ambedkar. I may have brought out some new material from Nehru and Patel and Ambedkar, but these two extraordinary public servants. Sukumar Sen, who was the first chief election commissioner, and Sardar Tarlok Singh, who resettled the refugees in Punjab. You know, I mean, they're two of the great stalwarts of Indian democracy. I mean, in a sense, people like all of us in this room are here today because of the contributions of people like Sukumar Sen and Tarlok Singh. So, here's the first part of my historical retrospective. India was rescued from ruin, was equipped with its first high quality education institutions, was its first made effective, its first science research, and so on and so forth, because of the superb performance of the state sector, who compensated, or dare I say, overcompensated for the underperformance of the private sector and civil society. Now, in these decades, the 1940s to the 1970s, the idea of public service was deeply cherished. The person who took state employment thought he or she was doing a noble work. And let me return to some personal experiences, because as I said, I come from a family of service. My father was a one stuff which I suppose the president or head director of the institute used more often. But my father was allowed to use that stuff when he was going out of station on government work. So to be ferried from the FRI to the Hebron railway station, which is about 6 miles, the staff car would come. Now this, we are talking about the early 1960s. You know, many of you will remember it, the younger ones would. I mean, we are talking about a time, the one thing that Paul Kurnick was right about was that the only functional gear of the master of the Fiat was second or third, right? All right. So there were no foreign cars. The FRI had a gleaming blue Dodge, which had been presented to it by the Food and Agriculture Organization. So that was the FRI staff car. So it had a beautiful blue Dodge, and it had a chauffeur who took great pride in his car. His name was Mahanan, and he had a brocaded chauffeur's uniform and a pink cap, and he came whenever to our house, whenever my father had to go to the station. And he was very fond of me. I had to roam around the campus as a child. Happy childhood and many loving people around me, and Mahan, I often pass Mahan washing his car when I cycled to school, and he had great fondness for me. But I could never sit in his car because my father would not even allow me to sit in that car, even to go to the gate, because that was the staff. You know, when my father said government of India, as a personal anecdote, my father was at top of his head. Okay, I could not use a staff car, let alone using the official telephone and anything else. The chaprasi of Plur was a darwali from the Pindar riding of Bhawani Singh. He would come at 9 o'clock before open the lab and come back at 5:30 after the lab was closed. And he would sometimes give the keys to me, and he would say, Beta, daftar ki chabi. You know, that daftar ki chabi, spoken with a kind of a sense that this is public property. This is sacred because it is public. Now, I relate these anecdotes to underline the point that my father was not an exception. It's not as if my father was a profoundly moral being. It was just the climate of terms. Most other government servants were as scrupulous as he. And not just most other government servants, also most other politicians. You know, there's a story of the burglary of the house of EMS Nambudripad, long-time Chief Minister of Canada. The burglar was caught, and he was found with 800 rupees and a gold sovereign after 30 years in public life. This other thing, completely true story of Gulzari Lal Nanda, who was twice Prime Minister of India, and who died in a one-room apartment in Ahmedabad, living in a bazaar right now. This is how those public servants did. So my father was not accepting. This was the climate of the time. This was the zeitgeist, the spirit of the time. This was the afterglow of the Gandhi movement. You know, two or three generations of public servants had been inspired by Gandhi revolution. Not just the idea of sacrifice, not only the idea that there is a clear distinction between private and public, but also the idea that our government has come, it is there for the emancipation. Now, 50 years later, the situation is very different, and I would like to return again to the analytical framework I began with. If you think of those three sectors on which democracy depends, how are they faring today? The private sector today is dynamic and risk-taking. There may be exceptions. I have made a distinction in one of my newspaper columns between what I call crony capitalists and creative capitalists. So crony capitalists are those who depend on the natural resources such as spectrum and coal and bauxite coal, which is state-scale estimate. Creative capitalists are those who depend on innovation technology and contribute much more in terms of creating. They're not into resource looting. And there's so many young entrepreneurs, including some in this room. Including a young lady who said that she's studying for a degree in management, when she comes back, she's going to start her own business. I mean, the kind of risk-taking ability of small, medium, large it's called India's New Capitalism. It's published by Paul Ray McMillan a few years ago. It's a superb study of the social deepening of the Indian business community. How it went beyond, family business. So previously, Banyas, Nagayana, two exceptions, both become entrepreneurs. And of course, the exceptions were, say, Parsis or Mangalai, Muslim, Kas. But now you find peasant communities, Marathas, Gaulas, Giravas. It hasn't happened in North India. One of the puzzles that Harish Dhawan asked is why is it that Jats have not, and Kshatriyas in UP have not followed the way of Gaulas in Tamil Nadu, Giravas in Kerala, Marathas. Also, if you look at people who cook up prestige institutions, I think Vijay said it in my example. Well, Vijay said in my example, no one wanted to become an entrepreneur. So they either joined an industrial house or they went off and did an MBA and joined one of these X. But now so many IIT people want to become entrepreneurs today. So you can see a kind of a zest and a creativity in the private sector. An ability to take on the world, a willingness to take risks, and interest in new technologies, new management styles, that is completely wrong. That was not there in the 50s and 60s. At the same time, the civil society, which is so... But, while the private sector has become much more daring and innovative, while civil society has become extremely energetic and active, the state sector has increasingly become corrupt and corrupt. There are exceptions. I believe, and I'm saying this not just to flatter the audience or to flatter my host, I believe most of India's leading scientists retain the idea of public service. It's a point I'll come back to in a minute. I believe most of India's leading scientists retain the idea of public service. But no longer most of India's most powerful judges, civil servants, policemen, tax officials, etc. And no longer most or even many of our political class. Today, increasingly, when it comes to those who willingly enter public service, especially at medium or high levels, what animates people to enter public service is power, prestige, and profit. Power, prestige, or profit. To be power, the ability to control lives. Prestige, because, high status, secondary to government, those who work in the state sector. This is less so. There are exceptions, I'll come to that in a minute. But this is adversely affecting the quality of our democracy. I think it's very important to understand, to go back to that model, that if you have private sector robust, civil society robust, state sector wobbling, and the whole school reform. So you need a renewal of public service, you need a renewal of competence, efficacy, integrity, transparency. Now, among young Indians today, there is a great sense of difference. There is a great love for this country. Someone like me who travels across the country, yesterday I was in my school, speaking to young students who are in a new business school. I mean, I speak to students in many, many, many places. There's a real sense of difference, of a love for this country, a desire to contribute to its welfare and growth. You see, for example, in the very large number of Indians who come back abroad. Because less and less the case before. I mean, those Indians who went to study the rest in the 60s and 70s, not many of them came back. But pretty young people want to get good education. They recognize that in some respects, Western universities are better at providing professional education than Indian universities. But they want to come back and apply it here and contribute to this country. But there is a real wellspring of patriotism among middle class Indians. And this is a broad-minded patriotism. This is not a narrow-minded or jingoistic or chauvinistic. This patriotism among Indian state is on display, for example, in the surge of philanthropic activity among our entrepreneurs. Now, this is relatively new in our history. If you look at the history of philanthropy in India, apart from the Parsis of Bombay and the Sheikhs of Ahmedabad in the 20s and 30s, most Indian communities stayed away. Most Indian business communities made a lot of money, stayed away from philanthropy. They may have been It's not just the Parsis, it's everyone. I mean, I'm proud to say that my hometown, Bangalore, has shown it on the way. I mean, look at the software engineers of Bangalore and what they did in education, health. And this is true in other places too. So, the patriotism our entrepreneurs today are more patriotic, I believe, than they were in the 50s and 60s. Our next insular day. In a sense, they want to contribute not just to their wealth creation and but also to the bottom line, but also to society at large. This patriotism is also on display in the search of brilliant, well-educated professionals, turning their back on lucrative careers in the private sector to work with poor and disadvantaged communities. I mean, this is quite extraordinary. You will find countless examples. I mean, I can give you many, many. Each of you will have examples like this. You know, I have a close friend who was at university with me, who did a PhD, who would have been a professor at Delhi School of Economics, but went on to work only from Bihar, or Bengali woman from Bihar, a Malayali who had studied in Bangalore, and all came together. You know, this is a countless example. I mean, you know, so the better woman organization, SEWA, in Gujarat, among the people who run it, they have degrees from Harvard, Johns Hopkins, God knows what, where else. Such the Society for Education, Action, Research and Community Health in Gujarat, in Maharashtra. And there are countless others, I think a few names, to show that you have a surge of superb civil society organizations making up for the failures of the state in sectors such as education, health, human rights, environmental sustainability. So these organizations are run by extremely well-educated, brilliant professionals who, out of a sense of patriotism, have given up, turned their back on lucrative careers to serve this country. Organizations that are completely secular, that are committed to gender and class equality, and are very exemplary. So you have to read a surge of patriotism and idealism. But those who are young, those who are intelligent, those who are patriotic, are taking to public service. Too few are thinking of joining the government. Because they think, and sometimes with good reason, that government service is subject to bureaucratic interference, to political manipulation, to colonialism, nepotism, and corruption, that they can find greater fulfillment for their ideals without being constrained by corruption and nepotism, either in entrepreneurship or in social action. And the image of the Indian state among young, educated, patriotic Indians has changed. In the 1950s and 60s, the Indian state had a warm and friendly glow to it. Today, it has a dark and forbidding big glow. To young and patriotic and idealistic Indians, it is no longer welcoming and warm, it is dark and forbidding. Is desh ke liye kuch karna hai, sher to sarkar se khare. That's the kind of attitude which too many of our bright and intelligent people have. But this must change, and this is very, it is crucial that we are able to renew the idea of public service among young and gifted Indians. We must make government service attractive, appealing, and challenging once more. We must make government service attractive, appealing, and challenging once more. How best to do this? I leave to everyone. I am a historian. My job is to illuminate, to diagnose, to understand, to reach some conclusions, but I can't really provide a charter of how to reform our services. But I'm going to leave you with one idea and one proposal. And this is something that has been in my mind for a very long time. I've written occasionally about it. And this may or may not be the right forum to state, but I should state it nevertheless. One way, one among several ways in which to make public service attractive and appealing again to young and gifted Indians is to radically reduce the stranglehold of the Indian administrative service. In no other democracy, do generalists corner the top jobs in the high levels of government. In no other society will a person who topped the exam 35 years ago automatically have a top. 35 years. Now, if you start discouraging this domination by generals of the top jobs at higher levels of our sector, it's not there in UK, in USA, in Sweden, in Norway, in France, in Canada, and it is really a structural problem that must be addressed. And to the best of my knowledge, and that's addressed for very long, to the best of my knowledge, the only Prime Minister to challenge this kind of world was a person much forgotten now. Or if remembered, remembered for the wrong reasons. His name was Morarji Desai. Morarji Desai was austere, forbidding, with quirky personal habits, but a man of great intelligence and administrative ability. You know, while writing India after Gandhi, I found a letter which Jawaharlal Nehru had written to C.D. Deshmukh about Morarji Desai. C.D. Deshmukh and Morarji Desai were having a fight in the 1950s. It was about when the Bombay should go to Maharashtra and Gujarat, and they were on opposing sides. Deshmukh being a Maharashtra and Desai being a. And there was a fight going on. And C.D. Deshmukh made some nasty remarks about Morarji Desai. So Nehru writes to Morarji, he says, there is no one I admire more for administrative ability, rectitude, and efficiency than Morarji Desai. And I say, as a footnote, Nehru would not have written that about his own daughter. You know, he says, I quote that letter at a time when Morarji and Indira were fighting for the Prime Ministership in 1967. And he demanded a great administrative ability. He lacked personal charm and charisma. He finally became Prime Minister only in 1977. As an old man, as head of government. But one of the things he did, which is now forgotten, was to bring qualified professionals at the highest level of government. You know, the Ministry of Agriculture, the Secretary of Agriculture was always an Indian Civil Service official. Until Morarji Desai made Dr. Swaminathan the first agricultural scientist secretary of the Ministry of Agriculture. It was Morarji Desai who made the brilliant and visionary chemist Navaraj Kumar secretary of petrochemicals. It was Morarji Desai who brought in an extremely qualified engineer, Manuel Menezes, to become secretary of defense production. And last but not least, it was Morarji Desai who made Manmohan Singh, but if I had to wait 4.5 years for the job, he resigned when the Janata Party came apart, and after 1980 that experiment was not. Not continued. In fact, it was reversed. So that the agriculture ministry, the petrochemical ministry, the finance ministry, all reverted to the IAS. Now, at this stage, I have to say that they are indeed some outstanding IAS. You know, some of the finest public servants I know are in the IAS. Some years ago, I dedicated one of my books to two outstanding IAS officers. And my next book, which is a collection of political essays, also going to be dedicated to an IAS officer. So I know some truly remarkable IAS officers. But you should widen your pool, in my view, as an independent, non-accountable member of this country, I'm allowed to throw out ideas. So I think one idea worth considering is that at the upper levels of government, from Joint Secretary onwards, for every post, there should be an open competition. So let's say there's a post which is Joint Secretary in the Ministry of Petrochemicals. There should be an open competition so that you have, shall we say, someone, an outstanding, a very gifted person who has worked in the petrochemicals industry in the private sector and now wants to contribute to public service. Has done 20 years of work, has made enough money, owns a block of shares in his company that will ensuring financial security, now wants to contribute to the country and also to be active in policy formation. Because policy formation is a very different and equally exciting challenge to as compared to entrepreneurship. So throw it open. So you have a joint secretary post in petrochemicals, the IAS officer is welcome to apply and to show his or her fitness for the job. But at that level there must be an open competition, similarly for issue secretary, similarly for secretary, so that you are not ruling out an outstanding, competent IAS officer who has domain expertise, who has the ability to learn, who is innovative, clear-sighted. So, from Joint Secretary onward, all jobs, in my view, must be subject to open competition to get the best possible person. We need much more max natural entry into government, so that outstanding professionals, having made their mark in the private sector, can now join public service. And there is no shortage of outstanding professionals. There could be lawyers who want to join the law ministry. Health professionals, doctors who want to contribute to health policy, education, right? There is no shortage of outstanding professionals who have established themselves and now are looking for a larger challenge and who are animated by an idea of public service that only an important influential government job can give them. So this is an open post, and to say, underline again, there's no reason why IAS officers also can apply for it. But allowing lateral entry at the joint secretary level, rather than only at the secretary level, would rather decide to be at the secretary level. And should be at the joint secretary level, because at that level, you bring in professionals with their expertise, and you allow them to grow within the government system. You allow them to understand how government works before becoming additional secretary. Or secondly, each promotion dependent on open competition. Now, it so happens that our scientific ministries, not all of them, but some of them, such as DBT, DAE, and DSD, have been largely insulated from the IAS model. You know, it's usually scientists who head them, which may or may not be why they function differently from other ministries. So that's something I think for the rest of you to consider. Finally, I would like to say that the model I'm advocating of renewing the idea of public service so that young, intelligent, patriotic Indians do not just have to exhibit their intelligence and their patriotism in the private sector, civil society, also have the opportunity of bringing it to the state, which is in many ways the most powerful agency in India to do good or ill. It can do much more good and much more ill than either the private sector or the civil society. I would say that the model I'm advocating, if it is to be properly effective, must be replicated in the state sense, right? If our central governments face a knowledge deficit, our state governments face an even greater knowledge deficit. We must, this is my last slide, we must, to safeguard and enhance our future prospects, our robustness, the society, our nation, our civilization, democracy, we must make the idea of public service attractive and appealing once more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Public service, you will do as much or more in a government than you can do in an NGO. Right? So I think that is where I think a historian will be useful.
On such a heterogeneous society like India, we have such a highly heterogeneous society in India. One person can't yet think of tomorrow, one will power me. The other person is so rich that he can buy it. Your order is based on this democracy, you should serve the society. Is it on the sector or which country in the world you have been comparing? Which country would you like to compare the Indian democracy and the Indian scenario based on this high level of people?
Well, see, I think India is a unique political system.
Let me ask you this. How does your wallet take into account the very serious and large heterogeneity of this country in every sector?
Better regulatory institutions, there too you need professionals. You know, I've given this knowledge deficit. I just want
the press. Now I worry that Ram's talk will have people billing to the rest of our talks the last couple of days. Fantastic talk, and thank you very much. First of all, thank you all very, very much for coming here and staying through the last 1.5 days. It's been absolutely fantastic. We have had talks which cover all the subjects, the history of the Department of Biotechnology from our former secretaries, what the DBD has been doing, what it plans to do, and also dealing with all sorts of contentious issues. And you have been the people who have been participating and also listening to all of us. So thank you very, very much. But very importantly now, I must also thank colleagues who set up this summit meeting and made it through. It was incredible work by all our colleagues in the Department of Biotechnology. I should actually, read out a list and thank them all, but I should say that there's one set of people who we must especially acknowledge. And these are people who are with us today, right from the birth of the Department of Biotechnology now. Some of them are recently retired. Some of the retired people have come from long distances. Others are very senior and who are very senior advisors in the department. These people are the anchor of the department. They have the cultural history of the department and they are training the future of the department. They and all the other colleagues in the department, in our administration, in our finance, in our buildings, who do everything there, have all come together to make sure that this meeting goes on well and is successful. They're immensely, I mean, I would say, thankful and grateful, except that, we're all part of the community. So if there's one occasion where we can congratulate ourselves and reminisce about our past and dedicate ourselves to the future, this is one. So thank you all very much.
Our Chief Guest Professor Abdul Kumar, Professor K. Vijayar, our Secretary, Dr. Renu Sarup, our Senior Advisor, our most valued to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion to all who have helped make this event global pattern by the Management 2016 event success.
Pandav Sindhu Dhara, मुझे जाना पड़ेगा ताकि मैं गिर जाऊंगा।
नहीं तो तुम कराओ मैं क्लिक करता हूँ।
चलो यहाँ से भी ले रहा ना।
सर प्लीज।
ठीक है सर। रेडी सर? यस प्लीज। वन मोर। यस प्लीज।